our Fort GS second vice president. She's in the director of the program. So rather than have her introduce herself, I thought I would do it. We're so lucky tonight to have her come bring a program on lineage societies, because that is one of her areas of expertise. When she really got serious about doing her genealogy, she jumped in and she joined just about everything she could. But she's been at it a long time. She started when she was in about the sixth grade or so. She is a member of 11 lineage organizations, from the DAR to Sons and Daughters of Antebellum Planters, Descendants of Texas Rangers. In 2016, she won the Mamie Wynne Cox Historical Research Award from the DRT, the Daughters of Republic of Texas. And in 2013, she received the National Spirit of 1812 Award, and that's through the Daughters of the War of 1812. She's a Corpus Christi native. She's traced her roots all the way around the globe. She writes a lot for newsletters and other lineage groups. She's a former radio, TV, and newspaper reporter. And she just recently had been, what was your title with the?
Director of Communications.
Director of Communications for HEB, and I used to see her on TV every time there was something bad happening in the schools. But she retired from that, and we are so glad, because now we have her a lot. And I bet you Arlington could get her too. Why don't you help me welcome Judy Ramos?
Thank you, Debbie. Let me see if this works. Slide this across. Can you hear me? Great. All right. We're going to see if this works as it should. Thank you for getting the lights. Thanks for the introduction. Thank you for coming. I know that we've got a lot going on. You know, the president's going to speak, and the weather doesn't look so great, so I appreciate those who decided to be here tonight. I really do appreciate that. And I've got like 60-something slides, and we've got about an hour. We are going to zip through some of them and then spend more time on others. And so we've got a lot to cover. If you want to stop and ask questions, you can. And I'll do the best I can to answer your questions. So let's do this. Okay. Suzanne, is this what we do to advance it, right?
Yeah.
This happened to me the last time I spoke here.
Why not let Suzanne have it?
Let me go get Renee a minute. This happened to me earlier and I fixed it on.
Okay. All right.
All right. That was only put in 2013.
All right. Let me give you a little bit of background. The first few slides are going to be some background about me as it pertains to this topic. And so let me go ahead and just tell you about that. And then that way we can zip even faster through those slides. I've been doing genealogy, like Debbie said, since I was in the sixth grade. And so I was at a book fair, I found a book about genealogy, and I was hooked. And there have been times when I didn't work on it, was busy going to college or whatever. And so I really jumped back into it in 08. And 2 years later, in 2010, I joined my first lineage society. That was Daughters of the American Revolution. That's the logo up in that corner. I joined DAR in 2010. And since then, I've gotten 10 other things done. And so I'm in Daughters of the Republic of Texas, I'm in Daughters of 1812, Daughters of the American Colonists, Society of Antebellum Planters, Bench and Bar, Dames of the Court of Honor, Descendants of Texas Rangers, Descendants of Mexican War Veterans, Texas First Families, and gone to Texas Pioneer. And in a minute, I'll explain the difference between some of the ones I mentioned, which are part of what we call certificate programs, and some that are true lineage societies. But for example, Daughters of the American Colonists, that is for someone who has an ancestor who was in the colonies before 1776. And so I got into DAR with my fourth great grandfather, John Everett. John's father was in the North Carolina militia in 1747. And John was in the American Revolution. And so because of John, I got into DAR, and because of his father, I got into DAC. Then John had, and he and his wife had some kids, and one of their kids was John Fagan Everett, and he was in the War of 1812. And so because of him, I got into to the War of 1812. And so there's a, I have a long history of military and lots of father, sons. And so, so we're gonna talk a little bit about some of those more well-known groups that you might have heard of. But let's take a look at this. If you can see this logo, this is Descendants of Quailing Masters. So those are, that's an example of a group you may not have heard of. And so that sounds like something that comes from the Northeast. Probably a few hundred years ago, if you had some ancestors who did that for a living. Over here in that corner there, the Associated Daughters of Early American Witches. And so I actually know somebody who's a member of that group. So that means that you are descended, and in this case, it's Associated Daughters, so you have to be a female to join. That means that you are descended from somebody, male or female, who was accused of being a witch, because there were men who were accused of being witches. So that is another group. Up there, this looks a little more familiar probably, the Sons of the Republic of Texas. And that, similar to Daughters of, you have to have an ancestor who was in Texas before statehood. That's how that works. Do we, how are we doing?
She's gone, but did Carol. You, is your flash drive in the back?
I think it's plugged, I think she plugged it in the back. In the back of the machine. It's a little red and black one.
Yeah.
Hey, Renee, it's not advancing.
Okay.
It's, it will advance on the screen, but.
Where's the, do you have the,
I've got the remote.
Does it have batteries?
While we're doing this, I would like to see a show of hands. Is anybody already in a lineage society? Okay. Oh, well, good. Which one are you with, sir?
Sons of Confederate Veterans.
Sons of Confederate Veterans. Who else had a hand up? How about you, ma'am? What are you in?
DAR and UDC and UDV and 1812.
Okay. And UDC is United Daughters of the Confederacy, and UDV, is that for Union?
Union.
So she's got ancestors on both sides of the Civil War. How about you?
Along with the Texas Windish Heritage Society. I'll give that.
Windish, okay.
Yeah.
And yourself? Well, you're in DAR. Okay. Anybody else that I missed? Is there anybody here who is trying to get into one? Raise your hand.
I just found out about sheriffs from you, and I think I know a sheriff. So.
Yes, there's a, we'll talk in a minute. There's a society called Constables and Sheriffs, and they have some of these, some of them have very long names, like the planters that I'm in. It's something, it's, I can't even say the whole name. It's like General Sons and Daughters of Colonial and Antebellum Planters, 1607 to 1861, or something like that. And so, so sheriffs and constables, we'll see some information about that. If that also goes back to colonial days. So if you have someone who is in law enforcement, a sheriff, a constable, a bailiff, and the other types as well, a marshal, you can get into that society as well.
Do they have to be? Can they be an uncle or a great-great-grand-uncle?
I believe that one is lineal, direct lineal only, meaning a direct line, not collateral. And so, and does everybody know the difference between that? A lineal ancestor means straight down. So like in my case, my fourth great-grandfather who was in the American Revolution, there's a straight line from him to me. A collateral would be like his brother. Aunts and uncles to me, great aunt, grand, yeah, fifth cousins or whatever. Those are collateral ancestors. And so there are a few that allow you to join if you have a collateral ancestor. Most of them, it's got to be direct line.
They'll advance it on the laptop, but won't advance it.
Can somebody drive for me?
Well, I tried that. It'll do it on there, but it won't show it there. So he's going to restart and see if that.
Yeah, I'm going to restart it.
Okay, so when we finally get this going, we're gonna speed through my slides. Okay, I asked a minute ago if someone was trying to work on a specific group. Did you have your hand up though? Which group were you trying to get in?
I'm working on the Sons of the American Revolution.
Sons of the American Revolution, okay. All right. Did someone else? Yes.
Okay, well, I've got, looking at the DAR, and then I talked to a biological cousin who's in the Sons of Colonial Warriors, which I have never heard of.
Okay.
And so I didn't know if there was a female daughter of one.
There might be. I know, I have a friend of mine who's in more than 60 of these groups. I'm in 11 And so I know somebody who's in more than 60.
American colonists, there's one, daughters of American colonists.
Right, and there's colonial wars. And one of the resources on your handout, well, both of those actually, Cindy's list and the other group, when you get there, they will show you all the different groups, and especially the second link, the Hereditary Society of the U.S. That one has an A to Z listing of groups that are out there. And most of them have websites that you can click on and get to. So what's going on, guys?
What are we on?
Okay. You had your hand up now. Did you? In the back, yes. And then I'll get you the steps. Right. War of 1812 was in the Alabama Territory, and then he lived in Mobile. Somebody else had it. Yes, ma'am.
My sister and I have been working on the Daughters of the
Daughters of the Okay, good. DRT. Debbie and I are both in the DRT, different chapters, but we're both in DRT. How's it going? He went into politics and he was a judge. And so I got into Benjamin Barr because of him. Yes, ma'am.
Does that include county judges?
I think it does. I don't remember all the criteria, so you'll have to look that up. But I want to say yes. County judge, I believe, works. Because he was a county judge and a probate judge. I went in, I was accepted because I submitted his information about when he was probate judge. But I think county would have worked. All right, let's go on. Here's some more. DAC, that's that one I was talking about, Daughters of the American Colonists, Texas First Families. So, and Descendants of Mexican War Veterans, that is the war from 1845 to 1848, where the United States was at war with Mexico over the southwestern part of the United States, and that determined whether the Nueces River in Corpus Christi would be our border or the Rio Grande. And so that was a short war, but it was an important one, and so I think, the last group that I got into. All right, here's what we're going to cover tonight very quickly now. We're going to talk about why should you join. We're also going to talk about what some of the membership requirements might be, the financial cost, because there is a financial cost, time commitment, and some other options in case you decide not to go the lineage route. So, I used to be a freelance writer for a paper called examiner.com. It was an online paper, and I covered Fort Worth genealogy happenings, and I wrote an article. I wrote three articles, actually, where I interviewed people in Fort Worth and asked, and they were all women who were in societies like me, and I asked them, why did you join? And this actually started because a cousin of mine emailed me. I have a network of cousins, Everett cousins, and I've met some and some I've not met, and we just talk online. And whenever I need something or whenever one of them needs something, we email each other. Hey, do you have, you know, I'm looking for an obituary on so-and-so or whatever. And so, and whenever I'm about to join a new society, I go to them if I need something. And so I can't remember which one I was trying to join. And this cousin wrote back and said, okay, Judy, I need you to clear something up for me. Why do you join lineage societies? She said, I don't get it. She said, is it just bragging rights and a certificate? I don't see the point. And so I said, you know, let me ask some people and get some other information. And so I sent an email to a bunch of my friends in some of the other societies, and I asked, why did you join? And these were my top four answers from these women. They wanted to honor their ancestor, preserve their family history. They wanted to perform community service and volunteerism, because you're going to learn in a minute that that's a lot of what these groups do. They go out, they do volunteer work, and or they shared, they had shared beliefs in the mission of the society. And so, Debbie, you participated with that. I remember I emailed you. So here was an answer from somebody when they said they want to honor their ancestors. She said, if I don't pay homage to my ancestors, no one will. And I know how many of you kind of feel that way anyway, that if it weren't for you doing this kind of work, nobody would be doing it. And so here's another one. Many of my ancestors lie in unmarked graves, and few have entries in the official records. Many of the women in my lineage in the early generations are identified only through the long ago marriage record. And she went on to say, because of that, this is why she joined, and especially the women, because we all know that a lot of times the women get very little recognition. Sometimes you can't find their maiden name. Sometimes on a census, they're just a tick mark, and they're not even a name. So it really meant a lot to this person to honor some of the women, especially. Preserve family history. I joined to honor my heritage and my lineage. Here's some more. Another reason, if you want to preserve your family history, once you turn in your application, those documents are kept, and they're secure forever. So they're either kept at a library, a university. If the society has its own headquarters, they're kept there. And sometimes lineage volumes will get published. So I mean, when this is your way to put your family, put them down, have them go down in history and secure your lineage.
And your work for genealogical.
And your genealogical work, absolutely. Community service and volunteerism. This is what some of the ladies said. I want an opportunity to give back. I want to meet new people and meet friends with similar interests. Because if we already like genealogy, then we're going to go do some volunteer work. So we already have something in common besides the fact that we want to do volunteer work. And so it's easy to make friends fast when you join because you have that common interest. So for example, DAR, we have something called the National Day of Service. This was back in October. And some of my chapter members went to clean the cemetery. There's a cemetery on the property of DFW International Airport. It's an old family cemetery. The family doesn't live around here anymore. And it's gated, and you have to have a key to get in there. But one of our DAR members is a member of the ULIS Historical Commission, and that is actually part of ULIS. As you know, some of the airport is in ULIS. So for our day of service, we went out there. It has a historical marker. And cleaned the Dobkin family cemetery. So that was our day of service. And in DAR right now, we actually are asked to log hours. We can go behind the scenes into the members only section, and they encourage us to log our hours of volunteer service. Oh, okay, a shared belief, and I'm gonna mention DAR several times tonight because about 2 weeks ago, I did a presentation about DAR, so the information was handy. So if I use examples from DAR, that's how come. But some people say, well, I believe the same thing that the society believes in. And in DAR, our mission is patriotism, historic preservation, and education. Whatever the society that you're thinking of joining, whatever their mission might be, if you have an affinity for that, then that might be a reason for you to join. There you go. And so somebody gave me this quote, every society that I am in does something beneficial for veterans, college students, or libraries. So again, you might be able to find something that means a lot to you. Veterans Affairs and taking care of our veterans is important to you. Then there's some group out there that does that and will pay attention to that. If education is something that interests you, then there's a group out there for you. Go back. Okay, now we're gonna talk about membership requirements. And this is in general. They want you to have documentation of lineage back to that particular ancestor. So if it's DAR, back to the person in the American Revolution. If it's SAR, same thing. So whatever, you've got to have documentation from you going backward to that person. Then you also need to have proof of their service or their membership in an organization or profession. So like, you know, we saw that about the whaling masters. Then you would have to have proof that your ancestor was a whaler, and so did whaling as a living. So generally, you've got to do those two things. You've got to show the lineage going backward in time, and then you've got to prove whatever their service or participation was. So using DAR as an example, They want documentation for every birth, marriage, and death, from you all the way back to that person who fought in the American Revolution. And then documentation for the service of that patriot. And so that's, you can substitute SAR or whatever for DAR, and it's pretty much how that works. So here's an example of what they call a worksheet. So you would put your name here, and this says, I was born on, so I would say, this is for DAR, so I would say, I was born on, I put my birthday at Corpus Christi, Texas, I married on December 17, 1988, at blah, 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 two, you put your spouse, he was born on, blah, 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 I am the daughter of, and there goes my parents, my grandparents, all the way. So that's how that goes, and you're going to need proof for every one of those in filling the blank.
When you say proof, you're talking about
a piece of paper.
Like census reports?
Uh-huh. And we'll talk about that, but some sort of proof. So in this case, what proof that I was born on whatever my birthday is? I'm gonna have to have a birth certificate. What proof that my parents married whenever they married, wherever that is? You know, what proof that so-and-so died? You know, so I've got to have some sort of a document for proof. Okay. Please don't get stuck. Come on. Get stuck. Come on. Oh, okay. I think that was the next one. So then you have to prove ancestor service. So the said, we'll use my John Everett. John Everett, who resided during the American Revolution at Tyrell County, North Carolina, assisted in establishing American independence while acting in the capacity of soldier. He was a private. Then you have to describe what did he do? What was his service? So they give you a little paragraph with space right here. And then give the source for the ancestor's service above. For published records, we need author, title, volume, page number, all that. So how do you know that he did this? That's where you write down whatever service record or whatever that is. Now you don't just write it down, then you provide a copy of it. So you end up turning in a packet that's pretty thick. All right, and then this is still on a DAR. So then, references. Give below proof for each statement of birth, marriage, death, and places and connections between the generations, from the applicant through the generation of the revolutionary ancestor. Always use title, author, date, volume, page, etc. So, first generation, so that's me, so I have to put, I would put like my name, and then I would say like Texas birth, whatever, Texas Bible Statistics, volume, whatever, blah, 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 and whatever the title of that thing for me. Same thing all the way down here. So whatever it starts to be, you fill that in. Whoa, 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 okay, jumps. Go back. Okay, and that's what you get if you make it. And so you get a certificate. So this has, it's got my name. When I joined, you get a national number. This has the date, and there's the name of my ancestor, and there's the state he represented. So, bragging rights and the certificate is my cousin Lisa.
So you could give one that says Sons of the Revolution.
Correct. Sons of the Revolution, yes, absolutely. If I push too hard, it jumps. Okay, here, I got, this is an excerpt from my 1812 application. It's legal size paper. And it's got, that's me, it's got my name right there. And that same thing, just like DAR. And so now, we're gonna go, it goes down here, there's Judith Lee Everett is the daughter of, there's my dad, has all my parents. And then right here, that and that is proof, that's proof, that's proof. And then it goes down, down, down. There's my great-great-grandfather. Remember, this guy's father is the one who was in 1812. So it goes to the sixth generation. Then over here, service. I need to fill in his service. Then here, it says ancestor married. He had three wives, not at the same time. And so you put that down, and then children, all his children, and then some other information, and then I blew up a piece of this. Here we go. This is the sixth generation. The said John Ross Jack Everett was the child of John Fagan Everett, Born 15 of March 1784, Tyrell County, North Carolina, died in Mobile, Alabama. Here's the date. His second wife, Sarah Brittenham, she was born 1797 at Mobile, blah, blah, blah. Then here's the proof. Birth and death, I give where it was cited. Sarah Brittenham, her birth and death, marriage is cited here. Here they allowed me to turn in tombstone photos. And so I went to Mobile and I got pictures of the tombstones for them. And so we'll talk some more about that. Some groups let you do that and some may not. So last year we had somebody here, if any of you were here, who talked about the Mayflower. So we're not gonna spend a lot of time on that, we've had a speaker on that before. But you too have to prove lineal descent direct from that Mayflower passenger to you. And they prefer vital records like birth, marriage, and death, but sometimes they will allow family histories to be accepted. And I'm gonna say this, you're gonna hear me say this over and over again. It depends on the society. Check with your society. Every one of them is different. The Mayflower Society has already done the research on the first five generations. So you had the pilgrim who came, and then five generations later, those five generations have been published in books called the Mayflower Five Generations. They're the silver books. They're here in this library, volumes and volumes of them. I've gone through them, and this library has copies of them. So then what you would need to do is, if you find an ancestor who's somewhere in those five generations, then you got to prove from yourself just to that person, and the rest has already been done for you. And you're piggybacking on what's already been done and published in that book. There you go. Here's another group called Hereditary Society Teachers. You have to have a lineal ancestor found in what is now considered the boundaries of the United States who taught in either basically from the 17th century to now, 18th, 19th, 20th, and even a 21st century teacher. So that is one of the lesser known groups. You have to have proof for each name, date, place. This is just like any of the other ones we've just been talking about. You have to have proof of their teacher profession. So you're gonna have to provide a piece of paper that shows they were a teacher. And I was reading their website, if they were like the dean of a university, that does not count. You have to show that they had classroom experience before they became dean. Yes, sir?
How about that book that was published in 1887 for virtually every county in the East? And if they say local school was on so-and-so's property and he was a teacher, is that?
I think that might work. And again, I'm just gonna say, ask the society or check their website. When you go download an application or when you get in touch with a registrar who might give you the blank application, every application comes with a set of instructions. Read the instructions before you do anything else, and the instructions will be very specific, and they will tell you in the instructions what proof counts and what will not constitute as proof. So it sounds like that probably would if it was a list of teachers in some published document. So now also, for this group of teachers, you may use approved application from another recognized society. So what that means is, if one of your ancestors was a teacher, but that same ancestor, let's say, was in the American Revolution and you're already an SAR, same guy, now all you have to do then, according to this, is provide a copy of your SAR application. That's already got all the proof, and you don't have to do it all over again for this group, is what that means. That happens in several groups. I've done that a few times. It saves you some steps. So we'll talk some more about that. But this is a group that allows that. And they actually have a list on their website. They have a list of the societies from which they will accept the applications. So you don't have to guess. It says the following groups, if you've got an application that's already been done and you're already in that group, we'll take that application. So you need to go to their website. So here's an example. I've got a screenshot of their part of their application. These are actually fill in the blank fields. When you type, the field gets larger and it gives you room to type. So you got your name. I hereby apply for membership, blah, blah, by virtue of descent from. Here's the name of the person, the state or colony of, who was born and died their year. And then you check off what century. And then you say, as proved by this documentation, and you fill all that in. here's another one of those worksheets. So I would say, I am, and I put my name, my birthday, born at, got married at, married to, all that. Here's my proof. My parents, was the son, daughter, and it goes on and on and on, as many generations as it needs to go back. Now, if you already had that application from some other society, you wouldn't have to do all that. You would just turn in that other one with a note saying, see this application. Associated Daughters of the Witches, we talked about that a minute ago. It's by invitation only. Somebody has to sponsor you. I'm in a couple of those where that's how I had to get in. Most of the time, like if you go to the DAR website or SAR website, they'll have, usually you have a registrar. The registrar is the point person who helps you with your paperwork, and that's who you turn it into. So usually it'll say, oh, please come to one of our meetings or contact the registrar. And sometimes some of them will say, you can download a blank application right here, right now, print it out at home or save it as a PDF or whatever. So a lot of times that stuff's already like at your fingertips. On occasion though, you'll find this, and there will be no document for you to download. It'll say, we appreciate or encourage membership inquiries. And then they'll have an email address. And so that means, like, that's all it'll say. And so that means you got to email this person and introduce yourself and say, I would like to join the blah, 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 Association of whatever, American Witches. You know, can you put me in touch with someone? And so what this means when you have to be sponsored, sometimes it's one, sometimes two people have to sponsor. You don't have to know them personally. What'll happen is if you don't know someone, then they'll say, you know what, let's see, you're in Fort Worth, we'll see if there's someone in your area, we'll put them in touch with you, and or one person's in Fort Worth and the other person's in Austin. We don't have that many people who are a member of this group, so they're kind of scattered around the state. And what happens is they kind of vouch for you, and sometimes they have to sign your paperwork. You don't have to be personal friends, but they may also look over the application along with the registrar. But I belong to a couple of groups where it was by invitation. Here's a really interesting one, Military Order of Foreign Lords of the U.S., because it has a dual kind of membership. You, if you are a veteran, a living veteran, you can join yourself as a veteran. Or you say, no, I want a hereditary membership because my ancestor was in a war. So you furnish proof of service of the applicant, yourself, or the ancestor. And then this website has a list of all the wars that qualify. And so it goes all the way back to the American Revolution. So I, as I was doing research for this, this was kind of fascinating because it's a different kind of group. But very similar. I didn't do screenshots of everything, but they have the same kind of a place where you have to document the service. So you're starting to get the idea of what these forms look like, and they kind of ask for a lot of the same kind of things. Come on. Oops. Hang on. There we go. Here's another military. This is just some more, and there are tons. This is not an exhaustive list. National Society of Daughters of Colonial Wars, 1812, we talked about that. The men's group is called General Society of the War of 1812. Continental Society of Daughters of Indian Wars, French and Indian War Society. So there are lots. And then this, that's my certificate for Daughters of the American Colonists. So here, it's for service from 1607 to 1776, but it has to be, I want to say before July 4th, 1776. The instructions gives you the cutoff date. And so this explains that that Nathaniel Everett, right here, Nathaniel Everett, who rendered loyal services in the colony of North Carolina. And anyway, this is the man who was in the militia in 1747. Dames of the Court of Honor. This, you have to have been a commissioned officer or a colonial governor during the periods of colonial wars, which is 1607 to 1775, I think that says, the American Revolution, the War of 1812, all the way up to the war between the states. So if you have an ancestor who was either an officer or a colonial governor in any of those wars, you qualify. And so here's where I double dip all the time. And so this guy, John Fagan Everett, Captain War of 1812. So what do we know about him? I'm in 1812 because of him. And so not only am I in 1812, I'm in Dames of the Court of Honor. Now, he was in the Creek Indian Wars. So if you go back a slide, you saw there was one about Indian Wars. I can get in with him. I can join that one with him because that was the Indian War. Sometimes you will find an ancestor and you can milk them for all their worth. And you can. I do that all the time. Descendants of Mexican War veterans. This is the son of the guy from the War of 1812. This is my great-great-grandfather who left Alabama and came to Texas. And so John Ross, he went by Jack Everett, and he was a civilian volunteer to the U.S. Quartermaster and in McCulloch's Texas Rangers. So so that's that, and there's the years of the war. So that's that group. Here's some Texas Lineage Societies, the two we've talked about already. There's an Alamo Defenders Descendants Association that allows collateral lineage. That's kind of cool. So I'm actually looking into that to see if I have any of that. So that means somebody who fought at the Alamo, but you don't have to have, it doesn't have to be that direct line. They don't have to be your great-great-great-grandfather. They can be your great-great-granduncle or fourth cousin or whatever. They allow the branches over here of that collateral lineage. Same thing with Hood's Texas Brigade. That's Confederate, that's during the Civil War. They also allow collateral lineage. So you can get in if you have a more distant relative or ancestor.
No, I've got collateral lineage. Alamo and Hood's Brigade.
Well, good.
So the SRT does allow lineage?
No.
No.
These two?
The last two.
Those two, it has to be direct. But these two allow collateral.
DRT or the SRT, you don't have to have fought.
No.
You can, a citizen of the Republic of Texas, you could have been a landowner.
Right, or rendered some other kind of service, supplies, or things like that. Women, too. It can be a woman patriot. It doesn't always have to have been a man.
But if you have documentation that shows that, like my great-great-grandfather and his brother was the one that was the famous one, they both fought.
Well, if they both did, then you would be able to get in not for the brother, but for the one who's your direct. Right.
Okay.
Yes, correct. Trades and professions. Remember we talked about the whaling masters a while ago? Colonial artisans and tradesmen, Flagon and Trencher Society, the descendants of colonial tavern keepers. I know somebody who's in that group. I think that was so cool. So she has an ancestor who owned a tavern in colonial times in the Northeast. Order of descendants of colonial physicians and chirurgeons, that's surgeons today. And so so if you have a colonial ancestor who is a physician, a surgeon, or a midwife counts, and I think there was one other one that counted. I was on their website. I know somebody who's in that one as well. So again, it doesn't all have to be war service. It can be a trade or a profession as well, or an accused witch. Yeah, that's not a profession. Some more, this is the sheriffs and constables that we talked about. That's the long name I was saying. Sheriffs and constables of colonial and antebellum America, descendants of pirates and privateers. I know somebody who's in that. I want that so bad. I don't have any pirates. I really want to be in that group.
I wonder if mutineers would count.
In what? Mutineers?
Mutineers.
You have to go to their website, but that is so cool. That and the tavern, man, I want that. Descendants of whaling masters. I think I might actually qualify for that. I need to look into that. So this is the Sons and Daughters of Antebellum Planters. See the law name, National Society, Sons and Daughters of Antebellum Planters, 1607 to 1861. It's a really long name. This is the man who was in the American Revolution. So I'm double dipping yet again. He fought in the colony of North Carolina, and when the war was over, he took his family to Georgia. They were one of the very first early families in Bullock County, Georgia. And so it says here, John Everett, State of Georgia, he went and bought bunches of land. And so he became a big landowner. And I've got the documentation to show that. And so that's how I got into that.
What's the distinguishing characteristic between a planter and a farmer?
I don't know. But
the number
just
of acres?
Maybe. You probably need to look on their website. Yeah. I don't remember anymore.
That would be in the south, below the Mason-Dixon line, all clear.
Um, probably, it's been a while since I joined this, so I don't remember the rules. I knew it better when I was doing my application. But it says here, duly elected a member of the society by right of descent from planter. So you have to look that up. And I believe that looks like tobacco right there. And I'm not sure if that, what that is. But so anyway, that, again, we're talking about trades and professions. Here's another one. This is that bench and bar I was telling you about. This is the man who was in the War of 1812 and who was a captain. So now here's the third thing that I'm in because of him. John Fagan Everett, judge of probate, ninth judge of the court, Mobile, Alabama, 1837 to 1842. Early settlers, we talked about Mayflower already. Here's another one, and then this is not the complete list, but as examples, Jamestown Society, founders of New Jersey. If you've got people from early Maryland, National Society of New England Women, and it goes on and on. And these are very long lists. I just grabbed four or five for each slide. There you go. If you have royal or noble ancestors, this is a few, there are more than this. Order of the Crown of Charlemagne, the Plantagenet Society, Sovereign Colonial Society of Americans of Royal Descent, or Order of the Magna Carta. And in April, we are going to have someone do a presentation on trying to find your royal ancestors. So if you're interested in that, come to the April meeting. There we go. Recognition for specific activities. If they were a signer of the Declaration of Independence, there's a group for that. Or the Hereditary Order of the Signers of the Bush Declaration. The Bush Declaration was from Maryland, I think, and it was just one of those declarations in favor of the war. And so if your ancestor signed that, then you can get in. Another type of group, Wendish, for example, like you were saying, ties to the old world. So Daughters of the British Empire, the St. David's Society, if you are of Welsh descent, or the Huguenot Society, and there are more. But so if you have lineage that is tied to a certain part of the old world, there may be a society that you can join. There you go. Let's talk about how much all this costs. It's different for every society. There's always an application fee. None of this is free. But sometimes your application fee and your annual dues, you know, it's all in one lump payment. You pay your application fee and then you pay your dues, and you're good for a year. Then you pay annual dues after that. Some groups give you an option to pay lifetime dues. It's like, you know, X number every year, or just pay this lump sum and we won't bother you anymore. And then sometimes the certificates are not free. Sometimes you pay for those separately. I know 1812, that is a separate fee. You get the letter, congratulations, and then if you want the certificate, here's an order form. So you check.
That's changed.
I think I had to pay for mine separately.
Really?
Mm-hmm. And there are some other ones too. So don't assume that the certificate comes with paperwork. Read the instructions, read the fine print. And then supplementals, that means you have somebody else who did the same thing and you want to join again. So for example, I'm in DAR because of John Everett. There's another man who is my fifth great grandfather, Daniel Britton, from South Carolina. He was in the American Revolution. So I'm already in DAR, but if I want to submit what's called a supplemental application and prove my lineage to Daniel Britton, then I can turn that in and I'll get another certificate that has his name. And then all my paperwork that shows me to Daniel Britton will be on file. So that's called a supplemental. The prices are cheaper and I don't think it's as expensive as doing it the first time around. What I've heard too though, like a DAR when you're joining, it takes, is it 8 to 10 weeks or something to find out, Debbie? I don't know. But the supplementals right now are taking about a year because they're not as important as getting new members in the society. So they go through all the new applications first and then someone is going through the supplementals. So we've been told that the supplementals right now are taking 10 months to a year to be processed. Using DAR as an example, since I just did that presentation, there's a one-time application fee of $150.50. It includes 1 year of dues. This is my chapter right here. Last year in 2016, dues were $60, and this is how it was broken down. So, so every year for me to stay in DAR, I have to pay $60. And I belong to 11 groups. So, now they're not all $60, but you can imagine things can start to pile up if they work. Some of them are only $20. And so you need to decide, that's one of those things you need to decide. When I quit working full-time 2 years ago, I stopped at 11. And so I have a bunch I would love to join. And I'm starting to think about joining one more. Now I'm trying to pick which one do I want. And so I've got to be careful because I don't want to work full-time. So I've got to be careful. And so you need to think about where you want your dollars to go. The supplemental application, we just talked about that, and there's an application process and a fee for that. Other examples of other fees. That Alamo Defenders is only $15 to $25. And it's, I think it's $25 if you're a new member, and I think if you have a supplemental, that's what's the $15. Hood's Texas Brigade is only $20. The Witches group is only $25. But look at the Teachers group. It's $350, but it's lifetime. They don't do the annual dues. You pay that $350 once and you're done. Same thing with sheriffs and constables. Bench and bar, when I joined, it was you pay so much up front, and now I pay $20 a year. But apparently, once April 2015 came around, they switched, and now they only do a one-time $230. So but that's kind of nice, is that, you know, one and done. But you, so you just need to decide. So,
I think the difference is the social groups, the groups that have a mission like EAR, they constantly have a
correct.
So they're, and they want you to join, they want you to be socially
yeah.
active, be a member.
Yeah,
but some of these groups, it's really truly to get your paperwork.
I was about to make that exact distinction. Take a look at this. The teachers, there's no chapter. Like Debbie and I belong to two different DAR chapters. DAR has chapters around the world, and I think there are 12 countries. I mean, we all have, every state has a state DAR, and then we got BUCUs and chapters. And so at the chapter level, we are trying to recruit members, and we are actually going out there, we are doing volunteer work. And so we'll talk a little bit more about that. So that's where our dues go. We give away scholarships to kids, we give things to veterans, we do all kinds of things. These groups do not meet. Bench and Bar has a once a year meeting. I just got my invitation. It's every April, and it's a joint meeting with the Planters, and it's in Washington, D.C. But that they don't have chapters, they don't have regular meetings. So you really are trying to join to get your paperwork on file and to be part of preserving your family history. So there's a reason why a lot of these are starting to switch. When I looked into sheriffs and constables 2 years ago, it was a pay once and then annual dues. They've now switched to just lifetime, but they don't have chapters and they don't have monthly meetings like Debbie and I do with DAR and DRT. So there's a reason why a lot of them are starting to switch to that. Let's talk about the time commitment. Time compiling all that documentation. So you saw what they asked of you. And the packets that you turn in are about a half inch thick sometimes, quarter inch to half inch thick. So you're gonna turn in a lot of paper. And so you need to decide if you wanna put the time in to do that. Then you have to decide once you're in, do you wanna be engaged and spend time? And then once you're in, you're gonna get a lot of mail. I get mail and I get email from everybody. And so do you wanna do that? Because you're gonna get listed in directories. You're gonna be part of the email group and the Facebook page and whatever. And so you need to decide what level of engagement you want. So for example, this was a couple of weeks ago. On February 15th, my DAR chapter, we were here in Fort Worth at the VA clinic, and we made sandwiches for veterans. We were downstairs and we were all had an assembly line, and we made sandwiches and we got the chips out and we stuffed the bags. And then when the veterans who were there getting doctor's appointments or whatever at the clinic, they came through, and the medical personnel, firefighter, anybody who was there got a free sandwich. So that took about 3 hours that day for me. 2 days later, I was with my DRT committee, and we were going through a pile of student essays. And so we were reading and judging student essays that are gonna go on to the next level of competition. So you have to decide, once you're in, how involved are you gonna be? Now what I'm gonna do is I'll get to go and log all those hours back into my DAR database. So let's talk again about documentation. Let's refresh. Generally, birth, death, marriage, especially the really particular, the first three generations, that's you, your parents, and your grandparents. Because they're kind of like, if you can't come up with documents for the first three generations, something's wrong. So they're kind of picky about that. Wills and other government documents are generally accepted. Sometimes they will take photos of tombstones, obituaries, newspaper articles. I say sometimes. Read those instructions. For example, dames of the Court of Honor, they will take Bible pages, but they will only take, this is what they told me, because I have a Bible, a page from an old Bible, but I just have a single page and it's all handwritten on. I used it with Debbie when she was my registrar beginning in 2012. With dames of the Court of Honor, they said you have to have the inside cover that has the copyright date of the Bible to show that it's really an old Bible. So they want you to have that copyright date, because it's copyright, you know, 1805 or whatever, printed in Philadelphia. They want you to have that, and then if you've got a Bible page together. So that's proof that that is from a really old Bible and that you didn't just make it up. So I couldn't use my Bible page for that, and I found other ways to get my documentation together. So every group is different. Read the fine print. All right. Remember, applications from other societies are sometimes accepted. When I joined Bench and Bar, remember, I went in with the ancestor who was in the War of 1812, and I had already joined 1812 first. So all I did, Bench and Bar was one of those groups that said, we'll take another application. So I made a photocopy of the application from 1812 and then put all the proofs behind it and submitted that with a letter saying, I'm not filling out your application, I've already got one. So then all I had to provide was the proof that he was a judge. And so it just saved me some time and some steps filling out all those fields that you saw. You need to show, the most important thing is to show that link from one generation to the next. And so, and remember, like, if you don't have a birth certificate or a baptism certificate, but you have a death certificate, usually the death certificate has that person's date of birth. That will work. So, you know, you've got two dates, important dates on one document. So try to remember things like that. If you don't sweat it if you don't have a certain document, because you can probably find it some other way. The important thing is to show the connection of one generation that this person was the son of this person who was the son of this person. So that is the seamless thing that has to happen, is to show the connection. DNA, right now I'm not aware of anybody but DAR. Is SAR accepting DNA? I know DAR is.
Starting.
But they've been since 2014, and they're very specific. And there's a whole page on the DAR website on how you can submit DNA results. And what it says is that in DAR, DNA can only be a tool. It cannot be, and they still are going to require all the other proofs. So I'm not really sure of the advantage of it, because it says you still have to do all this other proof. So, yes, ma'am.
Well, I'm just wondering, because, like, my case, my mother was adopted, so her parents weren't married. But I do know who they are.
Okay. For DAR, using DAR as an example, you have to join with lineal bloodline. So if somebody is adopted, like if the applicant, you know, if I was adopted and I wanted to join DAR, I would not be able to go in with my adoptive parents. I'd have to go in with my birth line, because they're the ones who actually serve. So,
right. So without having a marriage certificate, that's not a stumbling.
I think as long as you've got, again, ask the society, but going back to showing the link from one generation to the next, if you don't have a marriage certificate, but you have something else that shows that this was the mom, this was the dad, and this was the kid, maybe a baptism, a christening record, or something like that. You may, and I'm not going to say that for sure, but if you, in the absence of some record, I think as long as you can show, again, that crucial thing is the link from one generation to the next. Yes, ma'am.
So court documentation for the adoption possibly might work. That's what you're saying.
It might, and we're supposed to have somebody coming in May who's going to talk about adoption. So she would be able to probably answer those questions better than I. But what I can tell you is, and I only know DAR for sure, they're very specific. It even addresses adoption on their website, saying that adopt adopted applicants can join, but they have to use their blood or lineage.
That's for DNA with help.
And that's for DNA,
yeah,
right. That's where DNA might need more help.
I've got the DNA biological link on the maternal side. I'm still working on
that. Okay, you're right, Debbie. That's where it would be more helpful. Then I had my brother take the Y-DNA test for a completely different reason. And so the Y-DNA test is the one that only males can take. And what it shows is that, and then they ask you when you're filling out the form to send your vial back, they say, do you put the name down of the oldest ancestor you know of. And I wrote Nathaniel Everett. And so when the results came back, what it shows is that I have a match with Nathaniel Everett. Well, for me, let's just say I wanted to join DAR right now. Nathaniel is not the one who was in the American Revolution. It was his son, John. It was his son, John. So all that does for me is point me in the right direction, but it doesn't point me to the patriot. I still have to prove myself to the patriot. But I think where it could be valuable is for something like adoption.
I have a cousin who did not know who her birth father was. She was allowed to join DRT, and it was just counted as, do you not know who your father is? I never did what she's getting at. I really don't know exactly how they did it, but her lineage to prove her service to DRT was on her mother's side.
So you didn't really need the father.
I guess. And they don't. They caution you, if you don't know the exact date, don't put that date down. I mean, if you think you know the exact date but you don't have a proof for it, don't put that down. You can put down he was born in 1832 if you can prove that by a census record,
But don't put March 10th, 1832.
Yeah, but you don't want to put down March 5th, 1832 because you can't prove that.
Right.
Unless you can.
And I've got that on my application. Sometimes I'll just, if I don't have a date, or I'll just say born, 1795.
And they will take circa or different ones have different rules.
That's why we say each society is different. Read the fine print. Let me tell you what happened with my descendants of Mexican War veterans. That one was a really hard one for me. I didn't have all the correct proof that they needed. It was the proof that my ancestor was in that Mexican War. I found newspaper articles that said that, because that war was covered around the world. It was covered in newspapers all over the world. And there were journalists embedded with troops just like they are today, and they would report. And so I had articles about Jack Everett and his escapades in the war. But newspaper articles is not one of the proofs that's accepted in that group. So I had to find some other things. And so he worked in the quartermaster's office. And we found that out because somebody wrote a book about a guy from a revolutionary guy in Mexico, and in there is mention of Jack Everett. It says that at the time, blah, 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 he was working in the quartermaster's office. So I found out that UTA has a special collections, and they have all this stuff on that war that someone donated. So they've got 7 rolls of microfilm from the quartermaster's office. So I'm like, I'm in. I just got to go get the document. The index roll was missing. So I didn't know which of those 7 rolls of microfilm my guy was in. They couldn't find the index. So I just popped in the first roll, and it's needle in the haystack, and I was just going, oh. And I was just scrolling, and I thought, I'll be here for years. And so I just gave up. And so I turned in a big fat packet and wrote a letter and said, I've been to UTA, and I turned in like the business card to the 2 people who helped me, and I said, it is not my fault that they lost the index, and I therefore have no idea which of those 7 roles has the name of my ancestor. What can you do to help me? And one of the other things that was in there was a personal letter that my ancestor had written that a cousin of mine found, so I threw that in there. I talked to the president on the phone about my problem. I mean, I was relentless. And then finally, I got a phone call that said, okay, you're in. And I said, how did you do that without the quartermaster document? And he said, you're right, it's not your fault that UTA lost the index roll. they took my packet and they gave it to somebody who is an authority on that war, and they said, well, you go through this and vouch for her. And so that's what they did. And then he said, but if you ever have a hankering to go back to UTA, please find that document and send it to us, because we would love to add it to your packet. Like, maybe one of these days, but, yes, Rob?
Wouldn't there be other depositories that would have those microfilms, and they have another index?
They told me that that was the only place that you could get it. And then I later found out what happened. I don't want to spend too much time on it, but let me get to the end of it. But sometimes they will find a way around it when something like that is not your fault. And so they actually just got a guy who's written books about the war. They gave him my packet, and everything jived. And so that's how I got in. Let's quickly talk about other options. So you don't want to do any of that lending stuff. You don't want to go to monthly meetings. You don't want to be a volunteer. There is such a thing as a heritage certificate. It's a one-time application. You get the certificate, you pay one time, and no annual dues, no meetings, no mail. Here's one from the Bureau of Indian Affairs, a certificate of the degree of Indian or Alaska Native blood. You need to show your relationship to an enrolled member of a federally recognized tribe. And then you get a certificate. Texas State Genealogical Society. Now here's where I've got three of these. Texas State Genealogical Society has a certificate program, they call it their heritage program, for 5 certificates. I have 3. Texas First Families, Gone to Texas Pioneer, Descendants of Texas Rangers. So when I say I'm in 11 lineage societies, I'm really in 8 true societies, and then these are 3. It's too much trouble for me to say I'm in 8 lineage societies and I have 3, but I just say I'm in 11 lineage societies. But I am truly, I belong to a group of people who descend from Texas Rangers, so it's sort of like a lineage society. I belong to a group.
You have to prove it lineal.
Yeah, the documentation is the same. What makes a difference is that you pay only a one-time fee. The documentation for Texas First Families is the same as what I have to do for DRT. It's just as thorough, and the packet is just as big. Same thing for, now Gone to Texas Pioneer is for sort of that next wave after statehood. They have to have been here before 1886. So I got in with somebody else who came after statehood but before the 1880s. And then Descendants of Texas Rangers, it only cost me $30. I spent more of the time was in compiling the documentation, because that is not any different. Only what's different is the fee and then needing to stay a member and dues and whatnot.
John Wiley just walked in. Will they take a... No, I'm sorry, John.
I thought it was too.
He's my husband.
Sorry, you look like somebody who's with this group. I thought that was John too when he walked in.
I was going to see if they would take DRT.
Yes, sir.
That Texas First Families, is uh-huh. that for our people that was here during the Revolution?
Yes, this is, for example, this is my Texas First Families. It's basically, it says here, Jack Ross Everett, that is my Descendants of Mexican War Veterans guy, son of 1812 guy, who resided in Texas or served the Republic of Texas before February 19, 1846, when the Republic of Texas officially became the state of Texas. That's the criteria. He was in Texas before statehood. It's the same as DRT, it's the same as SRT. The only thing is, it's one time. But the documentation was just as thorough, and I had to do everything I had to do.
And they print really nice books and put them in libraries.
And then these are saved in a library and they publish books. Oh, hang on. This is the other one. Gone to Texas Pioneer. This is for an ancestor on my mother's maternal side, Severo Alaniz, and he who lived in Texas prior to 1886. So that's sort of the next wave. So if your ancestor came a little bit later, get $30, certificate, done. This is my Descendants of Texas Rangers. This was Jack, Mexican War, and the other guy. I dipped with him all the time. Served, and here it lists all of the war units he was in. And this was before I found out he was in McCulloch's Texas Rangers. That's not listed. I found that out when I was doing the Mexican War research. So it lists he was in Captain J.W. Cleveland's Mounted Company in 1839, Wilson's Company in 1839, Peter Bell's Corpus Christi Rangers, 1845, and then he was in McCulloch's Texas Rangers. So he was a ranger 4 times. But there are lots of them. This is just a few. There are tons of certificate programs around the country. So from Chicago, Arkansas has 5 different kinds of certificates. Tennessee has first families, but then they also have a Civil War Tennessee certificate. So you might find one if you have ancestors from another state or another city. Chicago, just for being an early settler of Chicago, you can get something. We're almost done. 5 minutes going to be closed. So let's recap. Why join? On your ancestor, preserve your family history, maybe community service or a shared belief in the work of the society. Once you've thought about why you want to join, things to consider. We've talked about membership requirements, the financial cost, time commitment, and if none of that appeals to you, you now know you have some other options. And you're so close. What are you going to do with all those certificates? This is several years old. This was when I only had 7. I now have 11. So like there's one right here, there's one right here. I think I got 2 here. So this is the guest room / office. So when people come stay with me, they have to look at all that. So that, and then the wall, that I have another wall over here, it's got pictures of my ancestors. So they have to sleep looking at dead people. And so I've got a whole wall full of ancestors, and then the other wall has this. So if you ever come stay with me, that's what you put up there.
Can your children ride your coattails?
Yes, children can get into some groups. There's Children of the American Revolution, boy or girl. There's Children of the Republic of Texas. And so usually that goes up to like their 16th birthday or 18th birthday, and then they can switch from their child membership and just fill out some papers and make the switch to their adult membership.
But they're using your information.
They're using your information. Something else that, you know what, that I didn't make a slide for, that we talked a little bit about. If you have somebody, well, and this is for DAR is what I'm really going to speak on. DAR has a database, a free database. So if you go to the DAR website, you can look at their database, and you can type in the name of your ancestor to see if he's already in there. So for example, if I type in Daniel Britton, he's already in there. That means somebody else got into DAR with Daniel Britton. And so I actually went and I got a copy of that person's application. You can collect $10, put a credit card, and they'll get you, you can get an immediate PDF of that application. So I have a copy of Daniel Britton, of the application somebody submitted for Daniel Britton. And one of the pages, you have to put in all their kids. It has the name of, I am descended from Sarah Britton. So now, I don't have to prove Daniel Britton's war service. For me to get in as that supplemental, we talked about supplementals, I just need to go from me to Sarah, his daughter. And then the stuff on Daniel's already been done. So I get to ride on the piggyback, on the coattails of an existing member who's already done the paperwork for service. I just got to prove to get from me to his daughter. And she's listed on the application as a child. So some societies will let you do that as well. That is the end of my presentation. We have about 14 minutes to get out of here because the library closes. I hope this was helpful.